Welcome to the AHRQ Innovations Exchange video series, Can This Innovation Be Scaled? This video focuses on innovator and expert exchange on the Ascensia Heart Failure Program. Speeding the uptake of innovations to improve healthcare quality and reduce disparities is an essential part of the mission of the AHRQ Healthcare Innovations Exchange. Speeding uptake was also the focus of the Innovations Exchange Roundtable on Scale Up and Spread. Innovators presented their innovations to experts on healthcare services. Experts included Amy Berman of the John A. Hartford Foundation, which focuses on geriatric healthcare. Janelle Moore of Via Christi Health, a healthcare service provider. Sharon Rising of Centering Healthcare Institute, a community health organization. Steve Shields of Action Pact Development, a nursing home consulting firm. Lisa Soonan of the Silos Group, a healthcare venture capital firm. And Adam Zavadil of the Alliance of Community Health Plans, a national association of insurers. These experts provided input on a number of topics, which included how to develop an innovation, how to assess its scalability, and how to scale it. This video will focus on all three topics. It features Linda Wick, a registered nurse and nurse practitioner who manages the Heart Failure Program. Let's begin with a brief overview of this innovation. The Ascensia Heart Failure Program offers outpatient care for patients with chronic heart disease. It provides chronic care and disease management services led by RNs. Outcomes include significantly reduced rates of rehospitalization. Over the past 5 years, the Heart Failure Program has achieved a rehospitalization rate of less than 5%. The national average is 40%. The program saves money. According to one study, post-program spending per patient is $43,000 less than spending before treatment. Let's take a look as our innovator and experts talk about developing and scaling this innovation. Lower the cost of the innovation.
As I read through the information, one of the concerns I have continually, particularly coming out of this sort of the C-suite hat, is, you know, we get very married to our current staffing models of must be an ARNP, must be an RN, et cetera, as I think about, again, you know, sustaining the quality that you've been able to do, but continually looking at lowering the cost of the program, my question would be, how do you see the staffing model, based on the fact that we've got shortages, based on the fact that we need to continue to drive the cost out, because I don't know if the payers are going to step up to the plate, but how do you envision the staffing model in the future? So 3 years from now, what does that staffing model look like? Are you going to create cardio techs? Or is there a way that you're going to start working with the families in a way that starts to offload some of the work that your current nurses do? Do you understand my question? And what role might technology play in that in terms of automated phone calls versus the nurse needing to make the phone call?
We have tried with our telescale program, we have really tried to make it as automated as possible in that patients don't get called unless they alarm. We use protocols for the nurses to be able to give extra diuretics if that's what's appropriate so that they don't have to chase down a provider to get the order for that and then call the person back. So when they're on the phone with the patient, they can say, well, your weight's up, you ate this. Yes, I can increase your Lasix for a couple days and see how things go. So we've tried to do that. To be honest with you, I haven't thought about cardio techs. I think heart failure is a very complex and oftentimes underestimated disease in terms of its morbidity and mortality. There are some studies that show that it has the same morbidity and mortality as pancreatic cancer. And I'm not sure that somebody other than a nurse to make those assessments over the phone would be good quality. The technology, we're in the process of working with Deer River, Minnesota, you gotta love that name, that's on a reservation. and very underserved area, and we can't get the Native Americans to come to drive the 2 hours to Duluth, and now especially with gas prices, nobody's driving anywhere. So we are setting up video conferencing and having the nurses do education video, which is a really a different skill set for nurses. And so a lot of learning has had to go along with that, but we are trying to use that technology. But you bring up a very good point. I have to think about using people other than nurses to do some of this.
Identify the core elements for scaling.
I think as you move toward a marketing plan, as you move toward thinking about national spread, the question comes up, which was also asked about the previous innovation, Amy, which pieces of this package are really going to be critical? Which parts of the staff do you have to have? You certainly touched on that. And I think that one can spread at the same time that you're answering those questions. If you get your spread sites to be trying stripped down versions and constantly monitoring what's happening, it's not that you have to wait till all the data are in. I'm not that much of an egghead. Okay, but as you go, you know, you need to say, these look like us to us to be the core elements. Try this. And then they may say, well, we tried that, but we had to add a role, okay, or we had to add a visit or whatever it was, and we found something else we could get rid of. And that kind of knowledge, I think, is what can generate the spiral of spread. But without that, you're liable to face some of these cost-benefit issues, providers that don't have, you know, even though there's revenue to be had here, they don't have the team, they don't have the champions. People are often the scarce resource, even when you've got the business case.
Clarify scale up and spread goals.
My reaction listening to you is: what is your goal? Do you want to make a company of this?
My personal goal: I would love to have this heart, because we know it works, and we know heart failure is such a nationwide problem. I would love to be able to export this program nationwide. We know it works. As I have set up a center of excellence, and we've had people from all over the United States come to Duluth, Minnesota, if you can imagine that, to learn about our heart failure program. But inevitably, they go back, and without a champion, they don't get very far. And so that's been a huge frustration for me, is I've given them the tools. I mean, they of course pay us to come, but I give them the protocols, I give them the tools, I'm available to answer questions, and they go back, and they say, well, our physicians aren't that interested, our administrators aren't that interested, and so, you know, 3 years later, nothing's changed. So for me, the goal would be able to disseminate this into different institutions, and because the more people we can help, it's not only the patients, but the families are so affected by this disease, because as you pointed out with childhood obesity, it's not just the patient that's in the hospital, their families are taking time off of work, and they're often elderly, so their kids are coming from Baltimore to see them when they're sick, and it's a huge cost. So that would be my goal.
Convince insurers that the cost savings are real.
I think from a broader insurance industry perspective, the thing that worries sort of larger insurers is that some of the savings may be illusory, that you're showing us money up front, but you may be picking our pocket around the back. So think about how I'd imagine that your admissions have decreased over the course of this heart failure. Have you decreased your department? Have you increased your charge master during this time? I mean, those are the types of things that insurers are like, well, your revenue, you know, even if your revenue goes down, you're just gonna come back to me next year and increase the charge master to make up for it. So, you know, how can you think about the financial package that makes the payers less skeptical about those savings? Can you create a bundle of care, for example, where you would charge a higher amount up front for that heart failure patient, and the hospital will take on some of those risks for the additional costs if they don't come to fruition? Or is there some sort of guarantee as far as the charge master? Or can you package it in such a way that makes the insurer more confident that savings are actually going to come back to them if they're going to invest in some extra money up front for these additional services?
Mm-hmm. You bring up an excellent point. As we were negotiating with one of the payers, they pointed out that over the past 5 years, and this is where when you're in a large organization, sometimes the right hand doesn't know what the left hand is doing. He pointed out that our lipid panel had tripled in cost. I was unaware of that. And of course, we're getting lipid panels on this population. But you're right, that's what our financial people had done, is increase the cost of lipid panels unbeknownst to the providers, and we're ordering them. And so you bring up a very good point about packaging it as a whole. Thank you.
Distinguish yourself from your competition.
As you think about spreading broadly out in the community, you have to think about your competition. You know, and how do you characterize your success and package your success differently from the Aleers of the world, you know, the many other companies out there that are very large and very well resourced, to spread your product broadly? Because most of the time, not always, but most of the time, the payers and the hospitals, to the extent they consider themselves payers, prefer to use an integrated disease management organization that deals with heart failure and COPD and asthma and whatever, and not to, you know, have 15 different providers or vendors for the different disease states. So how can you either broaden your offering or, you know, and or differentiate yourself from the pack of people who've already commercialized products like this?
I'm so glad you asked that question, because
we have
contracted with our own payer. You know, we're self-insured health partners, but one of the things that we realize when we have negotiated with these payers and we've taken heart failure away from the disease management companies is that heart failure is one of the most overdiagnosed illnesses out there, because people are misdiagnosed all the time. And so you come into the ER with shortness of breath and you get heart failure on your problem list. You have swollen ankles and you get heart failure on your problem list. And so when we first did our first negotiation with a payer, and they gave me 500 people, and I'm going, oh my God, how am I gonna manage 500 more people? And I started going through those charts, because as the provider, we have access to those charts, and realized only a third of them had actual heart failure. And we've done 3 payer contracts now, and that has been consistent across the board. So when you're managing 500 patients and only a third of them have heart failure, your statistics look really good, because two-thirds of those people are never gonna hit the hospital with heart failure. Yet the disease management or the payer is paying for scales and nurse time to educate those people who don't have heart failure. So the benefit that we have is that we're the provider and we have access to those records to say, yes, indeed, this person does have heart failure, so we can target our resources appropriately.
Target marketing messages to specific audiences.
As we are developing new innovations, we have to figure out really innovative ways to get the message out. Mm-hmm. And think about, again, who our target population is. So who are you wanting to market to? Do you want to grow? Do you need more patients? Do you need more referrals? Do you want the community to understand what you're doing? Do you want to get a lot of press? One of the groups that can help you with marketing are the patients who are already in your program, mm-hmm. who are receiving a lot of benefit. And I'm sort of thinking about a patient steering committee, a group that would work with you, come up with messages that would be appropriate, and especially as you go to some new communities, bringing in potential patients, but community groups, community advocates from there, because the message is really important. We do a lot of work with what we call the Indian country, as they call themselves, Indian country groups, the tribes, and the messages are very different, and bringing in the tribal leaders to really help with getting their appropriate message out, I think would be really important. So just some ideas in terms of marketing.
Great. Well, that's great ideas, thank you. I think as healthcare providers, we just haven't really marketed ourselves, or it's a different world for us.
Yeah, well, take a page out of the pharmaceutical company.
Yes.
Yeah, exactly. Something we can learn from pharmaceutical companies.
It's really hard. So I've had lots of years of sort of working with that, yeah. and trying to figure out how not to sound too excited about what I'm doing and yet really excited about it, and how to get people on board in a really appropriate way so they buy in and it's not a turnoff, but it's really a buy-in.
Use outside experts.
And I think you can go places with this program. If your goal is really to disseminate, is I would get outside of your fishbowl in your provider organization, get permission. I would get a third party in to help you create a dissemination master plan and a business plan for proliferation, and then which would include a marketing group. and this is really important. Your target market right now is not the users. You may need them for your original pilot place, because her suggestion is very smart. Get some testimonies, etc. Build your story as part of that business dissemination plan. But your target is going to initially is going to be not just the payer, but also your dissemination sites, and they're the toughest sell of them all. So I think you need to get a total business plan help created by a third party that includes a marketing plan, and you can go national in a very short period of time.
Position your innovation for scaling.
To me, you know, a project that is nearing readiness for scale up and spread like you, that really, you know, has a business case, a return on investment that is really beginning to be poised, would be a national advisory board. Not a local advisory board, not simply patient stories, but a national advisory board to help you think through the market, the industry, pay for performance, quality indicators, how it fits with ACO, all of the changes that are going on out there, and where this may fit in different kinds of payment environments, structures, different kinds of quality changes that are going on. The other is, you know, you've really come to the point, I'll try to keep it short, but the other point is that you've come to the point where you're a prophet in your own land, and I think most people never get to that point. You know, that they're willing to spread it to five places within your system. But clearly you are still internal. You know, you've got internal support, which is really terrific. The question for me is whether or not you are willing and whether you have support in your environment to even go outside of your environment. And these are some very tough questions that you're going to have to explore, and I think an advisory group would likely be helpful for you. But then you are going to have to think about what is a training infrastructure, because you can't be at the center of that universe. You know, you're going to have to think about wave training. You're going to have to think about, you know, how do you do regional trainings to create capacities in kind of your low-lying fruit that are engaged in the work. Because you really are talking about, at this point, you're training people and they're not actually implementing. That's a very common problem in the early process of adoption, very common. And part of it is that they really haven't, oftentimes innovators have not prepared the potential adoption site to engage, to do the right kind of stakeholder assessment, to engage the right kind of people and decision makers in even the process, because that training can't be applied until it's ready really to be implemented. So that readiness piece, I think, is the last piece for you.
Thank you.
What is the fundamental infrastructure to deal with the 70% of the Medicare population, which is fee-for-service? That's going to be a sweet spot for you in terms of being able to really grow out in terms of your replication.
For more information on this and other healthcare innovations, please visit the AHRQ Innovations Exchange website at www.innovations.ahrq.gov.